Chaos malware targets Windows and Linux. Exchange zero days remain unpatched. Ransomware is targeting schools, and the giveaway winner announcement. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for October 4th, 2022. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. Let's go ahead and jump right into the news this week. A new botnet is currently infecting both Windows and Linux PCs and devices like servers and home or office routers to launch DDoS attacks and use them for crypto mining. It spreads by searching for unpatched security vulnerabilities and using stolen SSH keys to brute force its way into targets and begin IP spoofing. This botnet is called Chaos, and it's based on Go, which is Google's open source programming language. It could infect a variety of devices, though, spanning from x86 and ARM processing-based products to PowerPC and MIPS as well. Chaos infects a device, gains persistence, and starts reaching out to its command server for continued commands, eventually initiating crypto mining and using the device for DDoS attacks. Security researchers over at Lumen's Black Lotus Labs discovered Chaos. They analyzed samples they found online to give some background on the malware, saying that it is written in Chinese, it's using Chinese-based C2 infrastructure, and it's hitting several industries, including gaming, financial, technology, and entertainment industries. It was first discovered back in April, but it continues to spread. Black Lotus Labs suspects that this is an iteration of Kaiji malware, which was also capable of similar attacks. The samples obtained were found to include specific CVEs for Huawei and Zycel, but the researchers note that the list of CVEs exploited could easily be updated to include more known vulnerabilities. The researchers also recommend network admins monitor for suspicious connections, use the indicators of compromise available on GitHub to track any kind of activity, and block the C2 servers from being able to communicate with any potentially infected devices. Since the botnet uses vulnerabilities to spread, keep devices updated and patched as soon as possible and make sure to change any default passwords. About 3 weeks ago, a Vietnamese cybersecurity company disclosed 2 security flaws to Microsoft through the Zero Day Initiative program, which impact Microsoft Exchange, and they are tracked as CVE-2022-41040 and CVE-2022-41082, and they were nicknamed Proxy Not Shell. The company, called GTSC, publicly disclosed these issues last week. Now, at the time, Microsoft confirmed that the vulnerabilities exist, and they are aware of targeted attacks in the wild, with attackers chaining those 2 flaws together to hit Exchange servers with remote code execution attacks. Microsoft also noted that threat actors had already used the 2 vulnerabilities to breach servers of around 10 different organizations back in August of 2022, but this could affect up to 220,000 servers around the world. Microsoft shared mitigations for the 2 issues, recommending that their customers disable PowerShell remote access for non-admins, block the known attack pattern through the IIS manager as well. Alternatively, admins can also run the Exchange on-premises mitigation tool, which was made by Microsoft, but this also requires PowerShell 3 with admin privileges running on IIS 7.5 or higher. Unfortunately, though, those mitigation techniques can be bypassed because it only covers known attacks with a known URL pattern. Due to the mitigation being so specific in their URL block, experts found this was insufficient in protecting against the attacks, and they offered an updated option that can cover a broader attack surface. Microsoft has not posted an update at time of recording. There are no patches, but the CVEs are listed as high severity since they can be used for privilege escalation and remote code execution. Both of these do require authentication, but that's as a standard user, but that could easily be done with password spraying. Biggest of shoutouts, to my Hush Puppy Perk level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos and for the support. And a huge thank you to my newest patrons, including Derek, for joining the Alliance at patreon.com/threatwire. My YouTube channel is youtube.com/Shannon Morse, just like my name is spelled, for everything from tech reviews to security tutorials. And also, don't forget to like and subscribe to Hack 5 as well. We do have a winner for the Wi-Fi Pineapple Enterprise Edition. I'm so excited to be able to send this out to somebody. Out of hundreds of comments, y'all commented a lot on my last ThreatWire episode. Our winner is Norman Lyon, who posted this comment on the last episode. Congrats, Norman. Please make sure to check out my reply to your comment for the directions on how to receive your prize. You must respond by October 10th or a new winner will be chosen. Thank you so much again for entering to everyone, and stick around for future giveaways. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel for those giveaways. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story, which is all about ransomware targeting schools. Earlier this month, the Los Angeles Unified School District was hit with a ransomware attack, and on Friday, they stated they would not be paying the ransom as the district could use that money for education purposes, or their students, rather, since paying a ransom never actually guarantees the data will actually be fully recovered. The group behind the attack, they're called Vice Society, they leaked the data publicly via their data leaking website, including a message to the U.S. Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Agency saying that the feds had wasted their time. Vice Society had previously told journalists they had stolen 500 gigs of data, but they did not provide any evidence of this until now. The leak is concerning. Some of the data pertains to folders that may be sensitive in nature, such as personally identifiable data on students and psychological assessments, legal documents, and business records. LAUSD responded by saying they would notify affected individuals and they would offer free credit monitoring. The superintendent confirmed the data leak via Twitter, saying that they were partnered with law enforcement and they were analyzing the data as well. Schools continue to be targeted, with this same ransomware group also targeting at least 8 other school districts and universities. According to a report by Motherboard, many schools have not disclosed how they deal with these attacks, turning down freedom of information requests by citing state laws, making it harder to understand how schools are protecting against these ransomware attacks. Experts do recommend schools use cloud-hosted systems and system backups for quick restoration purposes. Having backups on a second network can also remediate a potential attack. Hey, I'm Shannon Morse. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you on the internet.